Here's the scene view of our entire model, and in the selection tree we see the different individual models that are now united in the scene view. Navis has countless navigation tools for investigating and exploring the composite model. We can use the View Cube, a 3D navigational tool that enables us to reorient the view of a model by clicking predefined areas on the cube. It allows us to quickly control the camera angle and is especially handy for achieving elevation or plan views. On the navigation bar, let's go to the full navigation wheel, which unites all tools in one spot. We can orbit. We can pan. We can zoom. And here also on the navigation bar, we can walk. As we drag our mouse down, we can lower ourselves. The look around tool allows us to pivot to change the angle of the camera. As we click our mouse and slowly move it forward, that'll engage walking forward. And we can turn to face the door. We can pass through the walls or doors to get inside and look at the interior of a space. Again, I'll use the Look Around tool to change my direction. When we click the center mouse button or the wheel and move the mouse up the screen, that'll float us up so we can go to another floor. And by combining these tools and with some practice, we can navigate anywhere in the building to achieve a multitude of perspectives. Just like video games, navigating 3D models requires a certain amount of hand-eye coordination that simply comes with practice. Another simple way to explore the model is through the selection tree. Now that we've brought in various models, let's examine further to see how they interact and relate. From the selection tree, I can highlight and right-click to hide or require any of the models or even the model components. And as I expand the hierarchy, I can drill down to a component level. In most cases, my components are organized by level. And don't worry that some are lacking a level assignment, since their position in 3D space is still understood. I can click individual components and they'll be highlighted in scene view. This is very similar to our project browser in Revit, since it allows us to navigate the project by individual model, by level, or by individual elements. And we can see the element names as they were imported. So by using my different navigation tools in conjunction with the section tree, I can examine how the different discipline models are interacting to check for any large errors or larger issues. Another very effective tool is the 3D sectioning. If we go to the Viewpoint tab, we can check Enable Sectioning, which brings us to a Sectioning Tools tab. There are two modes of sectioning, both by plane or by box. Right now, in the plane mode, I can select any one of the six planes with which to cut the model. By mousing over the gizmo, I can pull and push the plane to get the desired view. Let's try the section box mode. We have the ability to move the box any direction by pulling the grips. Or we can scale it, which means to change the width between any two of the opposite planes. Mousing over one of the grips, I can push or pull in order to stretch in order to make wider or more narrow the box in any one of the three directions. And in this way we can create even the most narrow cross sections of the model, which could be very helpful in isolating very specific regions of the design. Also, we're able to rotate the section box or section planes using the rotate command. This enables a gizmo with controls for rotating. In this way, we can create some very complicated sectioning geometry. Viewpoints are an important feature of Navisworks. They not only allow us to save and return to views of the model, which are of importance, but they can also be used for design review audit trails and for setting up model animations. Viewpoints can optionally retain saved attributes as well, no matter the changes we make in the course of navigating, so that on returning to a viewpoint, the camera angles, sections, overrides, and hidden items are reinstated. Let's make our first viewpoint, which will be the result of using a slanted section plane to get a terraced cutaway of the building. From the home, choose Save Viewpoint, and we'll give it a meaningful name. Within the Save Viewpoints window, we can rearrange the viewpoint hierarchy, add or delete files and folders, rename views and folders, update viewpoints to save the current scene view settings, and override any old settings. We can also change whether it's a perspective or orthogonal view. Let's go ahead and create and save viewpoints of interest by combining different camera angles, cutting sections, and/or hiding or requiring elements or whole categories of elements. Let's make some viewpoints that isolate out one or a couple of disciplines, and we can also arrange them into meaningful folders. Here I'll create a combination of structural MEP and here a simple structural framing. And here a plumbing model. All these saved viewpoints can facilitate our work later on as we recall these views in the service of our design review. Here we can take a bird's eye view of the restroom area, and we can include that into a folder titled Plumbing. We've already looked at using camera angles and hiding in order to manipulate views, but let's take a look at how we could add color overrides to add emphasis. Here in the retail space, we can notice that the ducts are interfering with the beams. Let's save a viewpoint that highlights this. From the selection tree, let's highlight all the level 1 lights and change them to a blue color. Similarly, let's select the beam and all its matching geometry and change them to a red color. Finally, I'll make one last override to the flex duct, making that a pink color. And with these three simple overrides, we've immediately called attention to these three components so that a designer can quickly see the issue. Now let's create another viewpoint where we use the section box to isolate out just the plenum space above an office. And in that viewpoint, we'll use some color overrides to emphasize the components of interest.